the three. This is the two. Moten rebounding. 1:39 to go.
Martinez has struggled from the floor. He's hit three three-pointers, but when he's penetrated the basket, he's missed some easy shots.
Jackson underneath, foul by Gresh. Four on Gary Gresh, top Green Bay defender, 1:28.
Syracuse very quick on picking up when the ball goes inside. Green Bay has been rotating their defense there. They were a little slow, but the post players get a bit double teamed, and they're passing it quickly to the weak side.
Ward on top of Penn, and upsetting Nebraska in the first round. Jackson, 5 points. Jackson, an 80% free throw shooter.
Jackson, who played on the 76ers team.
This is the second one, but Syracuse rebounds.
Big rebound by Otis Hill.
1:20 on the clock. 2 points, Syracuse lead. If they get through, Jim Boeheim will be wiping plenty of sweat from the brow against this tough Green Bay, Wisconsin team. We've got 104 to play here. Syracuse leading by two, the number four over number 12. And Adrian Autry makes it 4 points.
The boards have really been a key for Syracuse this whole game, and also penetrating in that lane.
Ludvigsen.
Some Autry. Big blocks by Syracuse.
That was Adrian Autry stepping that shot. Green Bay will keep the ball. 47.2 seconds left. 61-57 Syracuse.
Ben Berlowski coming into the game. He's a three-point shooter for the Phoenix. Gresh, a defensive specialist, going out.
Ben Berlowski, number 34, sophomore guard from Janesville, Wisconsin. He has it from Martinez. Vandervelden shoots from outside. So can Martinez. Berlowski is the best. He drives, and he's there. 36.9 seconds left.
Good penetration by Berlowski, but watch Hill take the charge. Stands his ground. Smart move by not going up to try and block the shot. Dick Bennett happy with the move, but not happy with the call.
So it remains a 4-point lead.
Wisconsin Green Bay foul, number 22, Gary Gresh.
And Gresh takes the foul. That'll be five for him. And Gary Gresh will leave the game with five fouls. Berlowski comes right back in to replace Gresh. And it sends Autry to the line, the senior guard. 78% free throw shooter, and of course the most experienced player on the Syracuse team. He misses the first. 30 and a half seconds remaining. A 4-point Syracuse lead. Gets the second. Now it's five. Vandervelden, Autry all over him.
Syracuse on a zone, making Green Bay spread things out.
Nordgaard short with a three. Berlowski on the rebound and a foul call on Syracuse.
Syracuse personal foul, number 15, Adrian.
Well, the winner of this game will advance to meet the winner of our second game this afternoon, Missouri and Wisconsin. Missouri, the top seed in the West, taking on Wisconsin, who ousted Cincinnati in round number one. 17.3 seconds left.
Wisconsin Green Bay substitution number 52.
Berlowski, an 84% free throw shooter. And he hits. LeDuc is back in the lineup. Eric LeDuc, a 6'7 senior who picked up two early fouls and hasn't played much since. Maybe one shift. Four-point margin. Three-point margin.
Substitution for Wisconsin.
Jackson comes in for Wisconsin Green Bay.
replacing Berlowski.
Berlowski goes out. Eric Jackson, the sophomore guard from Milwaukee, number 12. And he immediately fouls Autry. That was Martinez, who fouled him. Sending Autry to the line and 16 seconds showing on the clock.
Well, Green Bay going to try and have Syracuse beat them from the free throw line. Autry was 1 of 2 the last time he was at the line.
Syracuse 18 of 24 from the free throw line, but Autry misses the first. Glimmer of hope for Green Bay. Makes the second, back to 4 points. Ludvigsen for Berlowski, and there is Moten again for a block. Ludvigsen follows. He can't drop it. Wallace rebounds. Fouled immediately by Berlowski with 5.3 on the clock. Lawrence Moten has been doing that all game long, anticipating passes, leaping high to block shots. And he earns that smile he has on his face there. Another big play for Lawrence Moten, the junior from Washington, D.C.
Moten with 17 points. Only 3 baskets in the second half, but it's been his defense that has really sparked the Orange men.
He had 29 points against Hawaii, but he's shown the other aspects of his game here as Syracuse will advance and await the winner of Wisconsin, Missouri next here in Ogden, Utah. 64-59. Lowski, and that is it. The number 4 seeded Orangeman of Syracuse had quite a scare from this scrappy, well-coached Wisconsin Green Bay team. The Phoenix couldn't shoot in the first half. It hurt them. And even though they tightened up and played Dick Bennett-style ball in the second, the quicker, more aggressive Syracuse Orangeman proved to be stronger at the end. 64-59, a Syracuse victory. And so Syracuse into the round of 16. And they will meet the winner of Missouri, the top seed in the West, and Wisconsin. That's our next game here in Ogden, Utah. Chevrolet players of the game from Wisconsin Green Bay, Jeff Nordgaard, another strong performance for him. And Lawrence Moten of Syracuse, 17 points, 8 rebounds, 3 steals, 5 of 6 from the free throw line, an all-around fine game. And now from Ogden, Utah, let's go to New York and Jim Nance.
All right.
With the rebound. Double teaming everywhere. Tied up, possession arrow, head the other way. Boy, Pierce was silent for a long time. Now that he's got the matchup he wants, he's played solid D all day. The senior really coming through, all Ivy League player. Great night to get 10 here in the win over Nebraska with 25. Playing solid now. 1:46 left in the ball game. 4-point Gators lead.
It's Anderson on Allen now. Fresh legs. Allen. Wow. Really have to question
the last two shots. Absolutely.
Yep. And so is Fran. He's saying, you know, you don't need that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're down 4. You only need 2 possessions. Yeah, I mean, that is a downtown Freddie Brown shot there.
That's why you saw his teammate with the towel over his head.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's no need to go to the bomb threes at this point.
Florida's starting to get a little nervous back in 87. They beat NC State in the opening round, then Purdue moved on to the Eastern Regional, where they lost to Syracuse.
Hill misses the front end. The Syracuse team that advanced today, they remember what it feels like to get to a Final Four.
Makes the second. 5-point lead by Florida, 1:30 left.
Still don't need threes at this point, but Maloney takes it anyway and still off the mark. Allen off the mark
from three-point range.
I don't have time.
You only need two possessions.
And not that big a deficit.
Exactly.
We're talking a five-point deficit, 1:15 left.
Well, they've got a couple of math majors out there. And if you're a math major and you look up there, you're down five. You only need two possessions, one of which can be a two-point shot. So stay in the offense and don't take the desperation shots yet.
Instead, Cross with 18 points on the afternoon takes it to the free throw line and drops in his 19.
And watch this little technique here. He rolls the ball and almost doesn't have it seated in his hand and still is able to shoot. Perfect foul shot. Watch it. Whoop. And there it goes. Now all of a sudden, down seven, now you gotta have the three. So they back themselves into a corner with bad shot selection.
Down by seven, 107 left. Moore, strong rebound.
Allen. Had to alter that shot.
Yes, he did. Good defense by Florida.
And a jump ball goes to Florida. This time they call it a foul.
51.9 remaining. Florida, the third seed, hoping to move on to the Sweet 16, leading Pennsylvania 61-54.
And Maryland knocking off UMass. Joe Smith with 22 points. And Billy, that's an impressive victory.
Huge victory. Atlantic 10 drops two teams out.
Break Brown, two shots.
Craig Brown of Florida looking to expand the lead of the Gators as he does it 62-54.
Some ill-advised three-point shot attempts by Pennsylvania down the stretch, and that very uncharacteristic for the Quakers.
Well, they certainly got away from a game plan when they were still well within their grasp to come back. Florida making them pay now with excellent free throw shooting.
It's been a solid defensive effort all afternoon by the Gators, and Foss right on top of Pierce.
They haven't given up on defense. Florida's played tenacious defense all day. The clerk fouling Pierce. You know, Jimmy, I mentioned about Maloney in the Ivy League making 36 of 36 free throws this year. Earlier this season, Florida had a run as a team where they made 36 in a row, including 27 for 27 against Tennessee. So if you wonder if they can make free throws down the wire, that ought to end that.
And again, you talk about the little things that helped Florida to the
position they did and ran to in the SEC, co-champs in the eastern half of the division with Kentucky.
And a foul call. Pierce fouling Jason Anderson. And again, we're talking about the little things. Lon Kruger certainly coaching his team well in the little things, because Billy, what his team did in the SEC, preseason picked to finish fourth and yet wind up co-champs. Excellent job indeed.
Well, you know, at K-State, he almost took a team to the Final Four. When he had Mitch Richmond, they got beat by Danny Manning's club in the regional final. And here's Pierce.
Fouls out with 10 points and 9 rebounds. Pierce averages 13. Rough afternoon, although he did come on down the stretch. And again, as you mentioned, at 6'3", Billy, he really had to battle in the land of the Giants today.
Yep. All the young gentlemen right there.
Back-to-back perfect seasons in the Ivy League for the Quakers. And you mentioned the last squads to do that, 69 through 70 squad and 70-71. Steve Bilski was an outstanding guard on that squad, and he, the athletic director at George Washington, soon to be going back to the University of Pennsylvania.
Yeah, he's had a rough afternoon. As AD of GW, his team lost today, and now he's seeing his alma mater and future team lose as well.
Anderson banging home the free throw.
10-point Gators lead. The three off the mark for Moore. Trice will try his hand at it.
Anderson with the rebound and is fouled by Barada.
Well, at this point, if you're Penn, there's no sense, you know, fouling just to create a score that is not representative of the game. To play this one on out. Terrific season for the Quakers.
Mm-hmm.
And they will be back with four out of the five starters returning next year with the experience of having this year won a game in the NCAA tournament. First time for in 10 years that an Ivy League team was able to do that.
And a whale of a job done by Fran Dunphy all season long.
Number 22, Scott Kegler, replaces Sean Price.
Price will take a seat. Donald Mockley in for the Quakers.
For Eric Moore.
And Eric Moore will take a seat.
For the Gators.
Clayton Bates into the lineup. Get a little bit of time. Clayton Bates came over to me before the game and said, Billy, we heard what you said earlier today. And what it was, I said, people said, can Penn beat Florida? And I said, no, the story is, can Florida beat Penn? He said, yeah, we heard that.
Motivation indeed.
Maloney. Too late, too little.
And they probably also heard Spine as opposed to Spain.
Well, one of the things that they will hear is going to Miami. Again, it won't be a home court, but it should be a home crowd advantage for the Gators.
Davenport shooting two.
More games still coming your way here on CBS. Second round coverage continues. Texas will take on Michigan. And with B.J. Tyler, boy, I'm telling you, B.J. Tyler has really been a spark plug for that Texas ball club.
Well, that game will be played, would you say, in the 90s?
I think so.
Yep.
Dimitri Hill. Wonderful game for Dimitri. He leads with 16 points and six boards. And they really spelled him just right. The man they tease about being just a biscuit under 290. Dan Cross out as well.
Break. It'll be Jim Nance and Clark Kellogg in our New York City studio. Florida advances to the Sweet 16.
The Alicia story is all too common. Children with their childhood taken from them. Fear of violence is robbing our children of their future. We must take away that fear and give them hope. We must give Alicia and all our children back their childhood. Working together, we can.
Do something now. Call 1-800-WE-PREVENT.
All right, next on tap, it's Wisconsin against Missouri out west. That tip in about 8 minutes. It's 7:18, Texas against Michigan. That audience will start out with bonus coverage of that Wisconsin game against Missouri. But Cinderella has arrived, the 10 seed into the Sweet 16. Maryland knocking out the two in the Midwest. UMass, and put that in perspective for us, Mr. Kellogg.
Well, they start three sophomores and two freshmen. This is an outstanding team, and they play with no fear.
And Penn's decision-making down the stretch, a little shaky there. It's fired up the
Well, they really struggled. They struggled all day long with their shots. And the one thing about Florida that you really don't give them credit for is how good they are defensively. They really make you work to get good looks at the basket.
And Syracuse held on for victory over Wisconsin-Green Bay. Okay, again, it's Wisconsin against Missouri in the West, and we'll take you there on the road to the Final Four as we continue after this message and a word from your local station.
Wisconsin Badgers, Michael Finley will be joined at forward by Jeff Peterson, the guards of Tracy Webster and Andy Kilbride, and the center, Rashard Griffith, this brilliant young freshman from Chicago, Illinois. Stu Jackson in just his second year, Norm Stewart in his 27th year. the fifth among active coaches in terms of victories, more than 600 in the win column for Norm Stewart. That is number five among the active Division I coaches in college basketball. And we're underway with the Badgers in red, a record of 18-10. The Tigers 26-3 are in the white with gold and black trim.
It's important for the Badgers to start out quickly. The games that they have done very well in and they've won, they've started out scoring right away.
Wisconsin ousted Cincinnati in the first round.
Missouri
struggled early against Navy, but then went on to win handily. 23 points from the bench of Missouri when Norm Stewart made that early switch in the first half. It paid off, and in fact, they have averaged 23 points a game from their bench players all season long, so it was a big part of their game. Webster, a senior, and there's a foul off the ball. First of the game. And it goes to Crudup, Javon Crudup, the senior from Kansas City.
Javon Crudup. His first,
and that's the key
foul
right there. He's the one big guy that they have. Missouri, they've got a lot of players off the bench. Mark Gathkins at 6'5 comes in, and they've got Chris Heller at 6'10, but Crudup is the guy they need in the game.
Yeah, Peterson handling the ball from Mequon, Wisconsin. We were collected from some folks who live there in the first round game, calling it Mequon. It is Mequon, Wisconsin. The turnover to the Missouri Tigers. Thames, the freshman, opens the scoring. Kelly Thames, 6'7 from Jennings, Missouri. Mr. Basketball in the state senior high school. Finley from outside. That won't go. Peterson rebounding and we're tied.
Good up-tempo game. Both teams like to score over 75 points.
Webster picks up the foul. He thought he had made a clean block.
Webster is guarding Melvin Booker, the Big Eight player of the year, and Webster maybe not as quick as Booker. Webster at 6 foot. Andy Kilbride, one of the best defensive players for Wisconsin.
Good up inside, throws up a half hook. 4-2 Missouri.
Pressure by Missouri. They're making somebody else put the ball off besides Webster.
Booker. Peterson did not want to be handling that ball on his end of the court. And now they press deep here, 2-on-1 at the baseline.
What he needs to do is just get it across the 10-second line. It's a man-to-man situation. Finley takes one dribble, doesn't go anywhere. Not a very smart move right there with the half-court line.
Missouri with a 6-2 lead. Griffith, and he's fouled by Crudup, his second.
Well, Rashard Griffith really bangs him coming in, trying to get position, and Crudup holding his own. Very upset about this second personal foul called on him. Just a lot of banging, really not a lot of contact, maybe on the arms as far as going up, and Crudup is very upset about the call. It's his second personal, though.
And we get to play 2 minutes.
John McDonough with Derek Dickey, Texas and Michigan. Gentlemen.
Thank you, Jim. As you said, the Texas Longhorns trying to pull off the second upset of the day here in Wichita as they take on the 3 seed in the Midwest, the Michigan Wolverines. The 2 seed, Massachusetts, is already out of the tournament as Maryland pulled off the upset here moments ago. The Terrapins will meet the winner of this game in the Sweet 16 in Dallas. Welcome back to Wichita. I'm Sean McDonough along with Derek Dickey. It's great to have you with us. There are many in attendance here today who feel Michigan is ripe for the upset. The Wolverines struggled down the stretch in the regular season, losing 3 of the last 4, and struggled again to get by Pepperdine in overtime in the first round. They have struggled as a team, but Juwan Howard has not individually.
Well, Juwan has been very steady all year for Steve Fisher, and Texas is going to have their hands full because they have to contain him because he's playing so well, playing under control with a lot of poise down in the block. What he's doing is using his body. He's gaining the position, the offensive position, and establishing it and not giving it up. And he's also bodying up on the defensive man. Take him down low, get a chance to kiss the ball off the glass.
Over the last 4 games, Juwan Howard has averaged 27 points and 9.3 rebounds points per game. While Texas has not played, while Michigan rather has not played particularly well lately, Texas certainly has. The Longhorns have won 9 in a row and 19 of the last 20, and they got by Western Kentucky in the first round despite an off night from their leading scorer, B.J. Tyler.
Well, B.J. was not consistent the other night, but we know that he's capable of coming back showing his quickness. But Texas has had to rely on a couple of other players. Albert Burdett, I thought, did a great job inside playing defense and also shooting the ball from the perimeter. But all the man for Texas is going to have to be concerned about is Roderick Anderson, because he's able to shoot the ball so well from long range, quick enough to get out in front of the break and also finish the play.
It was definitely a night to holler about for Roderick Anderson, as both Anderson and Albert Burdett had career highs in points in the win over Western Kentucky. Burdett had 26 and Anderson had 25. The starting lineups for Texas, the forwards are Reggie Freeman and Albert Burdett. Rich McIver, a transfer from Michigan, is the center. Terrence Renshard, B.J. Tyler, the guards. For the Wolverines, it's a three-guard lineup with Jimmy King, Jalen Rose, and Dugan Fife. Juwan Howard is the center. Ray Jackson, the only player listed as a forward. The Texas Longhorns at 26-7 overall, coached by Tom Penders in his sixth year as head man of the Longhorns. He took Texas to the Final Eight in 1990. The first round win over Western Kentucky, due in large part to the second half three-point shooting after 0-for-10 from beyond the line in the first half, 6-for-10 in the second half against the Hilltoppers. Steve Fisher, the winningest active coach in NCAA tournament play. His team at 22-7, went to overtime to beat the Waves in the first round and won it with 10-for-10 from the line in overtime. Fisher does indeed rule overtime in the tournament in his 5 years as head coach of Michigan. The Wolverines are 5-0. Tom Harrington, Art McDonald, Frank Scagliotta, the official. Juwan Howard will jump for Michigan. Jalen Rose called the first game of this tournament against Pepperdine, one of the worst performances of his career. He'll try to bounce back today. Burdett jumps for Texas. Howard controlled it to Jalen Rose, and we're underway. The final game to be played here in Wichita.
We're going to keep an eye on the quickness of the guards of Texas, trying to force Michigan not to get the ball down inside, and when they do, keep them from getting second-chance shot opportunities.
No surprise with the way Howard's been playing of late. They go right to him for the game's first shot and bucket. And no surprise that the Longhorns push it quickly up the floor, and Rich McIver scored for Texas.
And the Longhorns have the ball in their possession. The shot clock is not going to be a factor.
Fife turned it over into the hands of Burdett. Terrence Renshard pushes and lays it in. Well, Michigan had 20 turnovers in the win over Pepperdine, and they'll face a lot more pressure from Texas than they did from the Waves in this game. Steve Fisher said, if we handle the ball like we did against Pepperdine, we'll have 20 turnovers against Texas in the first 10 minutes.
And that is very, very possible with the quickness that the Longhorns display, not only from the guard position, but also from the forwards.
Jalen Rose coming off that subpar performance against Pepperdine, knocks in his first shot, a three-pointer, and the Wolverines lead 5-4. Renshard wide open for three. Well, fasten your seatbelt, folks. This is what we expect for 40 minutes.
Excellent patience by the Longhorns. Even though they will run the fast break as every opportunity, they have a lot of patience on the offensive end. Look to get the ball inside, and we'll pitch it back out for the three-point shot.
Now, Michigan will try to slow down the pace when it can. Of course, the Wolverines like to run, but they don't want to get into a track meet with Texas. Howard stripped by McIver. Dugan Fife able to run it down, then he was fouled by Reggie Freeman. First foul on Freeman.
Reggie Freeman, a 6'5" freshman out of the Bronx, is another extremely quick, very athletic player. Plays the passing lanes well with his hands and moves his feet.
Neither team has missed a shot yet. Texas 3 out of 3 from the field. Michigan 2 for 2. Juwan Howard long with it. Albert Burdett the rebound. Tyler has NBA three-point range, but missed that shot. King bumped by Ty Freeman. That's two quick fouls on Reggie Freeman. That's not that big a concern for Texas. It is a deep Longhorn bench. Freeman only played 10 minutes against Western Kentucky. Freeman takes the seat, replaced by Tony Watson.
Tony Watson on the floor has to have a big game for Tom Fender's team.
Tom thought he could have a big game today because he's a three-point shooting threat, and he thought the Michigan Wolverines might back off along the perimeter and let Watson shoot it.
Well, the way the Texas guards shoot the ball, it doesn't even have to be from the perimeter. It can be from the locker room.
Dugan Fife, guarded by Tyler. Ray Jackson. And the Austin native has his first bucket. And we're tied at seven.
Michigan wants to show poise on the offensive end and not get rattled by the quickness of the smaller Texas guards.
Tyler quickly down the lane, then missed the layup. McIver muscled in the score.
Rick McIver did a very good job of fending off Juwan Howard underneath and be able to get that shot off.
Fife on the pass from King, missed the layup, batted to the corner and saved by Watson. 9-7 Texas, they have the ball. We've played 3 minutes. Tyler slipped, he tried to blow by King and then got called for the travel.
Travel because he tried to get up with the ball. Had he stayed on the floor, he could have even rolled around and still passed the ball. But as he tried to get up, that's when the travel is called. Take a look at Tyler. He's going to lose his footing, and he loses it, stays with the ball. Had he made the pass from there, fine. But as he goes to his knees, that becomes a turnover.
As we come back live, a scramble and another turnover by Michigan. Two turnovers committed by the Wolverines in the first 3.5 minutes. Tom Fender says he doesn't care where those three-point shots come from. If they're open, the Texas guards are going to take them. And there's Watson for three. Coach Fender thought he'd get a couple of those opportunities, and right off the bench, Watson drives in his first shot from beyond the line.
B.J. Tyler is trying to get that dribble penetration and taking the defense with him for the dish off.
King was fouled. Count the basket.
Michigan is not going to back down from Texas, even though they're overplaying out front. Jimmy King, take a look at Tyler. B.J. Tyler's going to try to drive inside Michigan. You see four defenders around him. He's able to get the pitch out to Tony Watson, who knocks that shot down from the corner, uncontested.
Jimmy King at the line. The foul was on Terrence Rencher, his first. The third against the Longhorns. King, long with the free throw, rebounded by McIver. McIver, who played his first 2 years of college ball at Michigan, then sat out last year. He transferred to Texas, been inspired by the sight of his former teammates. Watson wears that wristband around his bicep, strictly for style points, we are told. Tyler had it swatted by Juwan Howard. Watson, a stylish three-pointer. He has two three-pointers off the bench, and Texas is up six early.
Texas is such an aggressive team when they go after loose balls, always looking to score, advance the ball one more pass.
And the pace has been the Longhorns' liking to this point. Howard working on McIver, got it to drop in. 4 points for Juwan Howard, the junior from Chicago.
Howard was very successful against Pepperdine, getting the ball inside. Michigan needs to continue to look.
Well, Michigan has done a very good job of controlling the pace of this game. They've run their fast break when they wanted to. They've also continued to look inside. Get the ball down low to Juwan Howard. Let him operate. He's had another terrific half. He had 20 points in the first half against Pepperdine.
King will play it in. Michigan will likely hold for the last shot. Already up by five, and they do send it out to Fife. Fife guarded by Anderson. He has to be careful with Anderson's quickness. Anderson got a hand on it. To the rescue comes Tyler. Fife calls a timeout.
Heads up play by the coach's son, Dugan Fife. We'll return for the final 7.9 seconds of the half right after this. Texas has just one field goal the last 5 minutes, and Michigan has opened up a 5-point lead. 8 seconds left in the half. King pursued by Tyler. Rose. Nice passing. Howard wide open. Short with it at the buzzer. Nice execution by Michigan, but Howard with a rare miss. What a first half for Juwan. 17 points and 11 rebounds. Ray Jackson, 12 points and 6 rebounds in the first half. And the 3 seed in the Midwest, Michigan, with a 5-point lead over Texas at the half. That's the end of the first half with the score. Michigan 41, Texas 36. Jim Nance and Clark Kellogg will be along with Pennzoil at the half right after this message.
CBS Sports' exclusive coverage of the second round of the NCAA Basketball Championship is sponsored by Oldsmobile, MasterCard, and by Goodyear Tires.
Play Temple, and as Leslie Visser reports, it's a matchup of two coaches who dominate the headlines the way their teams dominate opponents.
For the first time in 59 years, two of the legendary programs in college basketball will finally meet. The matchup zone defense against the motion offense. Winner take all to the Sweet 16.
I think we are very much alike in what we do in terms of structure. The team is one where they are fundamentally sound, and there's no guesswork about where they're going to be on the court.
You've got to be aggressive in attacking the zone, and we'll have to be very aggressive in attacking their zone. If you don't attack it aggressively, you just are not going to create any openings.
This game has all the elements. No, not just great defense and excellent shooting from the field. It has all the drama of Bob Knight and John Chaney. Temple and Indiana, our own bonfire of the vanities.
Both coaches are emotional and passionate, and they never fail to command the attention of fans, officials, and of course, their players.
If you were to talk to the kids from Indiana, what do you think you might ask them about Bobby Knight, and what might you tell them about John Chaney?
I probably would say, is he as crazy as you see on TV? And they probably asked me, what about John Chaney? I was like, hey, this man is a maniac.
I know it's gonna be a lot of hollering and screaming out there, and the referees gonna be shaking in their suits.
I don't think there's gonna be any more emotional than it will be with most coaches. I think that you watch coaches and you watch sidelines, what you end up doing is missing the hell of a game.
You'd think that after a combined 51 years in coaching, these two men would have gone head-to-head on the hardwood before, and it looms as an enormous challenge for both.
They're going to present a lot of big problems for us because they're so sound fundamentally.
While not many people would confuse the two, John Chaney sees a little bit of himself in the man from the Midwest.
Many letters have come in recently calling me the black neck, but nevertheless, I respect him highly. Truly one of the mainstays in basketball, and certainly deservedly so.
Well, you heard Eddie Jones call his coach a maniac, but you know, there's really, don't mistake it, folks, a lot of love by the players to each of their coaches.
Yeah, when you think about those two coaches, you think about passionate people, and they're certainly excellent basketball coaches, and I'm sure we'll see that passion on the floor tomorrow between both teams.
Can't wait for this game. In fact, this will start off triple header Sunday for you, 12 o'clock Eastern time. It all gets underway. The whole nation will get this one. Indiana against Temple. Tip time there. Mark it down as 12:15 Eastern. And then that'll be followed by four games. The main game to the nation, Boston College against North Carolina. That's the headliner. Then the third set tipping around 4:40, Georgetown against Arkansas. By the end of tomorrow, we'll be down to that complete Sweet 16. One other thing, though, really impressive in this tournament, the play of some freshmen.
Yeah, there have been some outstanding freshman players. Joe Smith and Keith Booth, obviously, of Maryland. You talk Ray Allen, Doran Sheffer at UConn. You also have to talk about the couple of big fellas at Arkansas, Wilson and Darnell Robinson. So this is certainly a tournament where we've seen some outstanding play from some freshmen.
Right, again, I'm still looking for that buzzer beater. Two games to go here on quadruple header Saturday. Second half coming up next. We'll get you back to your games. Thanks for watching Pennzoil at the Half right here on the road to the Final Four.
Pennzoil at the Half was sponsored by Pennzoil, the motor oil you can rely on for performance, protection, and quality.
His win over Pepperdine, how relieved he was, and he said he didn't care if it was an ugly win or a pretty win. A one-point blowout was all that matters to continue to advance in the tournament.
His quote was, "We don't care if it's a knockout or a split decision. All we want is the win." The program's now at the point where if they don't win by a lot, people think they had a disappointing game. That's not the way the team feels. Watson called for the foul. Three fouls on Tony Watson.
Every foul from this point on is two shots, as you alluded to a few minutes ago.
Rich MacGyver comes back in. King is 0 for 3 from the line tonight. Mrs. King perplexed by her son's inability to deliver, and somebody needs to revive Jimmy Senior. Still a four-point game. Michigan by 5. Minute 25 left.
Two possessions for the Longhorns. Get the ball inside. Your guards can get the shot off at any time.
Anderson powers in on Fife and scores. Tom Penders gets a quick timeout with a minute 10 remaining. Michigan by 3. We'll be back on CBS right after this. Michigan has the ball on a three-point lead, a minute 10 remaining here in Wichita. Ray Jackson is fouled out for the Wolverines. King and Rose playing with 4. Wrencher has 4 for Texas. After the timeout, the Horns have only 1 left. There have been 10 ties, 12 lead changes in the game. And it's been another agonizing night for the coaches' wives. Dugan Fife would be the man to foul of the Wolverines on the floor. Or Olivier St. John, and King's not a bad choice either. Ordinarily, he's a decent free throw shooter, but he hasn't been tonight. Third. The coordinating producer of NCAA Basketball on CBS is Bob Diggis. Tonight's game produced by Bob Monsbach. That's him. And directed by Sandy Grossman. That fellow's name was Bob Monsbach. And a wonderful fellow he is. The coordinating producers of the Road to the Final Four are Eric Mann and David Winter. Directed by Bob Matina, and the executive in charge of production is Rick Gentile. 1 out of 5 from the line. 1 out of 6 from the line. Missouri is the 7th team to make it to the Sweet 16. The 8th will come from the winner of this game. Michigan, 11 out of 24 combined. That's a big one. It makes it a 2-possession game. 4-point lead for Michigan. A minute 5 remaining.
The Longhorns have to get a good shot in this possession. They do not have to force up a 3.
Tyler forced one up.
Through for his team after struggling most of the game, gonna drive and penetrate. His outside shot's not going. Take it to the hole, try to get the foul, and get to the line.
Susie and Sonny Penders celebrate. The foul is on Fife, his 3rd. Texas down 2. Tyler 8 for 8 from the line, still perfect. He's made all 9. 1-point game, 56 seconds remaining.
Longhorns do not have to foul.
Rose is guarded by Wrencher. Howard. King grabbed by Burdett. 4 fouls on Burdett. And remember King's struggles from the line tonight. 41 and a half seconds remaining. That Derek mentioned earlier, in tournament games decided by 5 points or less, Steve Fisher is 11-0. The favorable bounce. He's 3 out of 8 from the line now. The lead is 2. And 3. 2 huge free throws when Jimmy King and the Wolverines needed them.
The ball goes off the leg of Anderson.
And Anderson commits the quick foul on Jimmy King with 30.7 seconds remaining. Oh, they didn't have to go for a three on that possession with plenty of time left, but now they might be in a situation where the three becomes a higher priority depending on how King fares at the free throw line.
I agree with that. They still have to continue to try to get penetration, and, you know, obviously if you can draw the three-point play, that's the best way to do it, but so far Texas has not shot the ball well from the perimeter, so they're going to have to either get the penetration and pitch it back out or drive to the basket to get the three-point play.
King has 2. Michigan has hit his last 3 from the line. They're 9. They sealed the win against Pepperdine with 13 straight. They made their last 13 free throws in that game. It's a 4-point game. You're right, Texas the other night did a much better job of going inside first, then back outside for the open three. They haven't been able to work the inside-outside for the open threes today. Michigan by 5, 30 seconds left. Tyler, double-teamed by Howard and Rose. Time ticking down. Tyler, triple-teamed off to MacGyver for the slam. Timeout, Texas. That's the last Longhorn timeout with 18.6 remaining. 3-point lead for the Wolverines. Michigan leads by 3 with 18 seconds remaining. Texas is out of timeouts. The arrow favors Texas. They're choosing not to have a man in the face of Duke in fight. He's free to run the end line. Need either a quick steal, or they don't get it, a quick foul. They get it in Rose.
You have to foul right away.
And Richer, I believe, will be whistled for the foul. And if it is Terrence, he has fouled out. And he has. Triple header of second round games tomorrow here on CBS. You'll all see Indiana and Temple beginning at noon Eastern time. Game 2, North Carolina, BC, Kentucky, Marquette, Arizona, Virginia, and Oklahoma State, Tulsa in Oklahoma City at approximately 2:25. Then at 4:40, Arkansas takes on Georgetown, Duke, Michigan State, or Louisville and Minnesota. 15 and a half seconds remaining here. Rancher has fouled out. Reggie Freeman has replaced him. Jalen Rose at the line with 13 points. 3 out of 4 from the line today. He has 2 shots. To a 2-possession game. Steve Fisher said last year the Michigan players felt the pressure to get back to the Final Four, and they didn't play as relaxed as they should have. So they really don't feel the same kind of pressure brought on by expectations this year. You wouldn't know it by the expressions we just saw. Timeout Michigan, they're up by 5. Tonight on CBS, it's Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman, followed by The Road Home. And Texas will be on the road home to Austin in 15 and a half seconds, barring some serious good fortune for the Longhorns. B.J. Tyler pushes and scores. Clock stops after the made field goal in the last minute. They inbound to Rose, and he's fouled immediately. So he'll go to the other end to shoot 2 with Michigan leading by 3 and 8.7 seconds left.
If you're Texas, all you can hope for is that Rose misses these free throws. They have 2 shots because they're in the double bonus. And if Rose is able to miss them, then Texas has a chance. If he makes 1, you're talking 2 possessions and the game is theoretically over.
Michigan has hit its last 7 free throws.
They've struggled for most of the game from the line, but have made them down the stretch. Should this score stand, and it seems that it will, Michigan will be the eighth member of the Sweet 16. They'll play Maryland in Dallas. Jalen, 6 out of 7 from the line, 7 out of 8. Tyler missed the 3. The Longhorn season will end at 26-8. Their 9-game winning streak snapped by Michigan. The Wolverines return to the Sweet 16 for the third straight year. And now about a couple of tussles here in Wichita from Pepperdine in round one. And from Texas today, Steve Fisher now 12-0 in tournament games decided by 5 points or less. It's on to Dallas for Michigan. They'll take on Maryland at Reunion Arena. The Chevrolet players of the game, Terrence Rencher of Texas and Jawan Howard of Michigan. Jawan at 34 points and 18 rebounds. Now let's join Jim Nance in New York. Jim?
All right, Sean McDonough. So Michigan 2 wins away from going back to the Final Four. And how about that little nugget there? 5 minutes to go. You've got a note about that.
20-1 are the Wolverines when they lead with 5 minutes to go. They know how to win the close one.
All right, so 2 from the Big 10, 2 from the Big East, 2 from the Big 8 in the Sweet 16. And we'll be back here tomorrow, 12 noon Eastern time, with Indiana against Temple. For Clark Kellogg, I'm Jim Nance. Thanks for being with us right here on the road to the Final Four. See you tomorrow.
City he loves, people in Tulsa that were outstanding to he and his family when they went through the tragedy of having a daughter diagnosed with leukemia.
And the the Arkansas fans starting to sense that they will be advancing, they will be going to Dallas, and I think you have to give the Razorbacks a lot of credit. They won this game playing Georgetown style, which really shows their versatility.
Nolan Richardson tells a great story about interviewing for the Tulsa job. Said he didn't go into anything fancy. He went in and told the people, Tulsa, yeah, you just had 4 straight losing seasons. You have a basketball problem. I can fix it. That was the interview. He got the job, and he did fix it. He took Tulsa to the NCAA tournament 3 times in his 5 years there. But it's a new era. Tubby Smith has done a marvelous job with Tulsa this year, and Nolan Richardson has Arkansas heading at least to the round of 16 for the 4th time in 5 years. The team that knocked him out last year was North Carolina. They're gone. 60 Minutes will be seen in its entirety immediately following basketball on CBS as the Razorbacks of Arkansas close out the final seconds. We've had a great regional here in Oklahoma City with the wonderful emotion of Tulsa, but form is held as Arkansas will get to the Sweet 16, defeating Georgetown 85-73. Our Chevrolet players of the game, Joey Brown playing his final game as a Georgetown Hoya, and Dwight Stewart, who scored 16 points, was one shy of his career high for Arkansas. Coming up next on CBS coverage of the NCAA tournament, Jim Nance, Billy Packer, Clark Kellogg in the studios of New York, with Greg Kelser, Ted Robinson saying so long from Oklahoma City.
He's laughing at you.
Okay, so Arkansas is headed to the Sweet 16. They'll be playing Tulsa in Dallas in the regional semifinals on Friday. There is one other game in progress right now out west in Sacramento. Minnesota and Louisville tied 52-all with 3:51 remaining in that game. We will not be able to show you the completion of this game right now. It's time for 60 Minutes, which follows next on CBS. We look forward to seeing you again on Thursday night at 8 Eastern time for the start of the Sweet 16 round here on the road to the Final Four Southeast. And West in action on Thursday, East and Midwest on Friday. Coverage begins 8 o'clock Eastern time. So, again, for Clark Kellogg and Billy Packer, I'm Jim Nance. Thanks for being with us on the road to Charlotte. Good night, everybody.
Skelter all the way, Al.
Yeah, they're kind of scrambling here, and that they could have had one more shot, but I tell you, this official has made a lot of great calls.
Bob Arnett, yeah. Tough calls under pressure. So we go to overtime. Autry scored the last 8 points for Syracuse. He had 26 in the second half. 5 minute overtime. Wow.
Wow. And he didn't score in the first half?
Nothing. Nothing. And remember, he had 3 fouls. He's got 4 right now. Foul trouble could affect the Orange Man as Jackson, Hill, and Autry all have 4 fouls. Crudup will jump center against Wallace. There's Moten, who has scored 25. Autry has 26.
You know, Dick, it's a game that's a shame what team loses here, because they're both outstanding teams. They both got momentum going into the Elite Eight.
You're right, Al. You don't need a team at back-to-back losses this year, and they won't now. Missouri has it. Booker.
They're back to the 2-3 zone.
Almost like starting the game over. They're on even terms.
Great move by Jim Boeheim, that pressure the last 5 minutes.
Forced a couple of big turnovers, and Autry took advantage of it. They have 8 seconds on the shot clock. Olinny out to Booker again with 4. Booker with a long 3. That was an NBA 3-point.
That was from the door of the hotel.
82-79 for Booker. His second 3-point basket of the game. He's got 20 points. Jackson for 3. Moten keeps it alive. Working his way in. Moten with now 27 points.
What athletes. That was just outstanding. And here comes the pressure again. They know they found the chink in the armor of the Tigers. Their Achilles heel, their belly, their soft spot.
And the Orange, but I'll tell you what, Jim Boeheim has done a terrific coaching job. Let her lose in this game. This is about as disciplined a Syracuse team as I've seen in a long time. But Missouri has the depth and the strength, and they got the shooters too. Lamont Frazier gets it across by passing to Olinny. Going to the hoop and draws the foul. So it'll be 2 shots at the line. Moten with his 4th foul. So now 4 of the Syracuse starters have 4 personal fouls. No margin of error here that way.
And you can't save them. You know, now if they foul out, they foul out. It's not smart in an overtime to take anyone out because you know you're only going to go to 5 minutes. Matter of fact, it's down now to 3 minutes and 35 seconds.
Olinny now 5 for 6 from the line, and Missouri up by 2. Syracuse has 3 timeouts, Missouri 1. 1 out of 2, Autry cleared.
Missouri got the timeout because you get an extra one for an overtime.
Knocked away. Good defensive play by Thames. He knocked it out of Hill's hand. But Thames has been an all-round star for Missouri tonight. Thames, good shot.
Good call, Dick. Outstanding freshman.
22 points for Thames. He came in averaging 12 on the year. 3 minutes remaining. And Autry short with it. And here's going to be Booker with an easy 2. And Missouri has opened up a 6-point lead with under 3 minutes remaining. Timeout Syracuse.
Good call. Red Autry lets it fly from our downtown there. Everybody on Syracuse goes into rebound. It becomes a long rebound, and Booker finishes.
This is one of those situations where you're in the right place at the right time and the ball bounces your way. Missouri has not missed from the field in overtime. Autry and Moton have scored Syracuse's last 22 points, and Moton goes to the floor, and he is fouled.
I believe that time they put that foul on Thames rather than on Kuda.
You're right, Al. Can you imagine Thames has committed only two personal fouls? He has 22 points. He's been great off the offensive glass, outstanding defensively in this game. A freshman from Jennings, Missouri.
What a pleasure, this man from Washington, D.C.
Moton makes both free throws. It's a four-point game and 29 points for Moton. There's that pressure again. 2.5 minutes remaining in the overtime session. First overtime. Bames has tremendous poise.
Want the ball to book his hands.
Olinney has it right now. 10 on the shot clock. Lead is 4. Frazier goes in, and he is fouled. It'll be 2 shots for Missouri. Both teams are in double figures in team fouls, and that is on Wallace. So Jackson, Wallace, Hill, Autry, and Moton, all with 4 personal fouls, Al.
Plus, Dick, there's a ton of time left here. Over 2 minutes.
Hill goes out. McCorkle checks in. Hill has scored 10 points tonight. And Lamont Frazier on the free throw line. He's 3 for 7 from the line. Glenn Robinson has scored 19 points so far as Purdue battles Kansas in the Southeast Regional in Knoxville, and it's a 1-point lead for the Boilermakers. And want to tell our audience, the conclusion of this game, we'll send you over to Knoxville for that Purdue-Kansas battle. You're one of the great players in the country. Frazier hits 2 clutch free throws after missing 4 out of 7, and the lead is 6 again for the Tigers.
I wouldn't force a 3-point. I'd still go for 2 if it's there. Take the 3 if you got it, but I wouldn't force it.
Jackson with the ball. And here is Moton. He misses a 3. Should have taken your advice, Al. Crudup got the rebound and was hit in the face. It might have been too early for Syracuse to keep hammering away at the 3s as Moton missed.
If either of these fouls are made down this end, this is bonus time. Bonus time means after the 10th foul, the team gets automatically 2 shots. Off this rebound, Krudup gets the ball and he turns, but there's a right there that kind of slipped across his eye. Scotty Mack got him. See, Scotty Mack comes in from the inside, and it's kind of a rake.
McCorkle with his 2nd foul. So Krudup will go to the line and shoot 2 shots. Missouri leading 89-83. They had a 6-point lead, and Syracuse came back to tie the game and send it to overtime. Tonight, Krudup has 8 points and 13 rebounds.
And surprisingly, he's been an outstanding center with him, but he's truly a power forward.
That's that donut you talked about, the man in the middle. They don't have his... Krudup misses the first. He's 2 for 7 from the line.
That wasn't a brick, that one. That was a cinder block. That was a boulder.
Off anything. There's the free throw story in the extra session. Missouri has missed 2. Krudup makes 1 out of 2, and that's all they needed because that makes it a 3-possession game.
And now they got to go from the trifecta world.
Autry picked up quickly by Krudup. Surprise, big man going out. Autry looked like he might have traveled first, but he was fouled and a blocking call against Missouri.
Yeah, I thought that he took an extra step that time, but now he gets automatically 2 shots.
Lamont Frazier with his 4th personal foul, so he's the first Tiger with 4 fouls, and Autry will go to the line. He has scored 26 points. What a brilliant game by the Syracuse guards. He's 5 for 6 from the stripe.
Both these coaches are running a coaching clinic here. They will not make a mistake. They're both pros. They've been around a long time.
27 years for Norm Stewart at Missouri, 18 for Jim Boeheim at Syracuse. Makes them both, 90-85.
Missouri has one timeout left. Syracuse has two. Here's that pressure again. Grudem gets rid of it into the hands of Booker. He's been a steady guard that way.
He's very fortunate, the big man, to get away putting the ball on the floor, Dick.
Got the big man Wallace out to chase him along with Moten and now McCorkle.
Three on one's too many. They'll get a chippy underneath.
Plenty of time on the shot clock, Al.
Good move that time by the freshman. Take it back out. Loads of time left. Eight on the shot.
Booker gets it in to Crudup. To Thames and to Booker, and he gets the basket. Kelly Thames with 24 points.
Now they got a score each time down. Syracuse and pulled some stoppers.
Horton with the three and a timeout called by the Orange Man. Syracuse calls the timeout and Adrian Autry now with 31 big points.
And all in one half.
On CBS.
Adrian Autry keeping Syracuse in the game has scored 31 points all in the second half and overtime. In fact, Autry and Moten have scored the last 29 points for the Orangemen.
Here's the touchdown pass.
Olini released. And a big hoop with under a minute remaining.
Give Storm and Norman credit there.
Here's Autry, has the ball knocked away. Jackson still has it. Missouri really coming out to meet the Orangemen, and here's another turnover, and Olini will put the exclamation point on here.
That's the nail in the coffin.
14 for Olini, and Missouri is going to advance to the regional finals. And an offensive foul called against the Tigers. McCorkle had his position, and Booker with his fourth foul, but it's too little too late in what has been really a classic regional semifinal.
I would think, I didn't see all the games, but up to now, the ones I did watch, this has been the best by far.
Timeout, Missouri. That's their last.
This is the key play in the overtime called by the coach.
And it's the home run toss, basket hanging, call it what you will. Olini got the big basket. After the timeout by Missouri, Syracuse turns it over with less than 16 seconds to go. Thames falls down and the final seconds as Booker is fouled with 8.1 seconds. Autry and Moten combining for 60 points tonight, but the Missouri Tigers, relentless, hung in there after a tie at the half, a tie after the regulation time, and outscoring Syracuse 17-9 in this first overtime session. And the Chevrolet players of the game are Adrian Autry of Syracuse, scored 31 points, did not score in the first half, and Kelly Thames, who ties a career-high 24 points for Missouri. And the Tigers will advance to the regional final for only the second time. Back in 1976, they lost to Michigan in the Midwest final, so they make a big advance, and their record will go to 28-3 out.
Autry, keep your head up. You've done a magnificent job. One of the better second halves played in the history of the NCAA by the young man.
Yeah, I'd have to say that Autry, who's playing his last game, took it upon himself to be the team leader. Great passer, but Autry with a brilliant second half. And the lead is 10. Syracuse will finish at 23-7. And Missouri, for the first time ever, beat Syracuse. Shot missed by McCorkle. And one of the better games you'll see in the tournament. The final score in overtime, Missouri 98, Syracuse 88.
Good. Sorry about that.
So the final score, Missouri advances to the regional final here and will play the winner of the Arizona-Louisville game coming up next. And right now, from the Sports Arena in Los Angeles, Al McGuire and Dick Stockton sending it back to our New York studios and Pat O'Brien.
All right, Dick, thank you very much. And Louisville, Arizona comes up a half an hour from right now from Los Angeles. Missouri advances in the tournament in overtime, beating Syracuse by 10 points, 98-88. The other game going on right now in Knoxville, Purdue
Glenn Robinson, the big dog, against the Jayhawks, leading 33-30. They're in the first half, about 5:19 left in that contest. When we come back here, we will send you out for that action. So stick with us here on CBS as the tournament in full swing. It's March Madness, folks. Hope you're having a good time. Stick with us. Duke beat Marquette 59-49. Marquette put up a little fight here in the first half of this game, and Marquette cheerleaders and Marquette came to play. Duke's Grant Hill, though, took over in the second half.
And the reason? Mike Krzyzewski got on his case. Grant a little too unselfish, but hey, nice job, 16 points in the second half.
Well, alley-oop to Hill there, and Grant just did it all. He feeds Cherokee Parks, who's toughing it up for the jam. He scored 16 points in the second half, as you pointed out, JB, and afterwards he spoke with our Andrea Joyce.
In the first half, I wasn't playing real hard. The coach got on me a little bit at halftime and just told me to be more aggressive out there. They're real physical, they're real big inside, and I just try to take it to them.
He's taking it to them, all right. They win by 10. Reminder that tomorrow night, our regional semifinal coverage continues with another primetime doubleheader. Down in Dallas, Nolan Richardson faces his old school Tulsa in the first Midwest regional semifinal. Then number 10 seed Maryland will try to stop Michigan, the 3 seed. Our Jim Gray spoke with Wolverine coach Steve Fisher about that matchup.
Coach, what's with your team? It seems as though every time you guys play, now it's a close game. There's going to be excitement for America. It's a little different feeling for you, isn't it?
Our intent is to keep CBS's ratings where you're going to want this tournament for years to come. We've been a pretty good show, and we found ways to win close games. Part of it's luck, but more important for us than luck is we've got good players. A year ago, there was immense pressure that we said not pressure. We were a number one seed. We were coming back from a championship game, and we had all our players back. This year, we're not as good. No, I mean, as point blank, we're not as good, but we could, on a given night, play better. So we're hoping. You can't lose not only Weber, but Riley and Plinka and Vasco and Tally and the rest of them and expect to be as good. But we've got a good enough team that we can come out and continue to win, and that's what we're hoping to do.
What about Maryland now? They kind of find themselves in the position you were in a couple years ago. Everybody's calling them the youngest team. Nobody really expected much about them. What about the Maryland group that you'll face?
They're good. They're legit. They're very athletic, very talented. Kerry Williams has done a really, really nice job with that team. And the way they played against UMass, 17 for 24 from the field the second half. Nobody can beat them if they shoot like that. We're hoping that they won't shoot quite that well and that we can come out and use our experience to our advantage rather than using the youthful exuberance to their advantage.
Which is better to have now, having been in both positions? Is it better to be youthful and not have the fear and not really know what's at stake?
Well, 2 years ago, that was the shoe I wore, so that was the only way to go. Today, bad to be young and inexperienced. It's good to be the veteran team.
Good to see him smiling, too. Steve Fisher and Jim Gray. Thank you, Jim. Want to catch up to date on what's going to happen tomorrow here on CBS. Our coverage begins at 8 o'clock with Boston College in Indiana. In your areas of natural interest, you'll join that game at the beginning at 7:30. The rest of us will come in at 8 o'clock, and others will see Tulsa and Arkansas, the number one team in the country. And it's a doubleheader around 10 o'clock. Maryland and Michigan kicks in, and Florida and Connecticut. Great matchups tomorrow night as March Madness gets in full swing and is in full swing as we head towards our Elite Eight. And then over the weekend, we pick our Final Four. Thanks for joining us on the Pennzoil at the Half. James Brown and Pat O'Brien saying hope you enjoy the second half here on CBS. Hope you're enjoying the tournament as well. See you later.
Pennzoil at the Half was sponsored by Pennzoil, the motor oil you can rely on for performance, protection, and quality.
You got the winning color!
Make your down.
Little box set with a slice cut. Pearson's supposed to go through, now he finally does. Nice cut by Woodbury. Oh, is that pretty? He was looking for Ostertag to come down and made a deep cut to the hole.
74-69. 4:15 to play.
Good job.
Another turnover from Roberts.
They played the pick and roll beautifully.
Ostertag. dribble it. Let's take the timeout. 3:50 to play in Knoxville. Purdue in the lead.
Makes coaching such a tough business. As the ball's reversed, Sean Pearson's supposed to kick. He gets the slice cut, step up screen. They end up with a basket, but because he doesn't go, Roy Williams is going, we're trying to run the play. Please, son, we've done it all year. Make that cut. And finally, Woodbury slipped to the goal and got the deuce.
Glenn Robinson has not scored in the last 8 minutes. 8 minutes without scoring for Robinson.
And after the timeout, that's a good sign that he needed a little rest. He went over holding his hips as he went to the huddle. 1-3-1 look all after the timeout.
3.5 minutes to play.
Always shaking the opponent. That's one philosophy they espouse at Kansas.
Robinson.
Oh! Fresh legs. Fresh deuce.
76-69. He has 42.
Starting in the post.
On the baseline, Pollard.
Richie used the bounce with a good look. Good play by Gurley right here.
And he'll pull it back out. And that finds Richie. 76-73.
Boy, you have to admire the Jayhawks. Incredible.
Protect the three against Martin.
And Richie, I think the fifth guy to guard Robinson.
Robinson gets it in the air. And the foul is on Patrick Richie.
We're talking about the heart, the metal, really sound basketball, because here he recognizes the numbers but keeps his vision. Spots the cutter, Richie, who's able to convert.
This is phenomenal. Porter Roberts, 6 turnovers tonight. You mentioned earlier he averages 1.3 a game. He had 1 in the 2 games they won last weekend. An off night for him.
I think Kansas makes you do some of those things as well. Scott now with the assignment. The back screen enables him to get a 3-1.
Way long. And Roberts chases it down.
Little ISO.
Robinson. Got it. 44 for Glenn Robinson.
Right now, it's laundry time. He takes you with the way he's playing.
Ball stripped from Scott inside, and here comes Waddell for Purdue. Under a minute and a half to play. The Boilermakers lead it 78-73 on the strength of 44 points by Glenn Robinson. And Scott with the near steal. Fresh bodies off the bench for Kansas. Scott Pollard, 31. Greg Gurley, 33.
Got a little trouble. Richard Scott there. Looks like cramps. You relax a little, even if you're great. And a team that gets after it like the Jayhawks will not let you relax. And Richard Scott down, and hopefully nothing more than the cramps, and he's up and at him.
And up with a minute 18 to play. We'll take a timeout and come back to Knoxville. In the orange top, Christine Bridgman, Glenn Robinson's proud mom. Glenn has scored 44 points here, what has enabled Kansas to stay in view of the Boilermakers is that the Jayhawks have shot 50% from the floor. They trail by 5, a minute 18 to play. And now the full court pressure by the Jayhawks.
Nobody playing the inbounder, so you'll see a double up. The free safety, if it shows. And look at this.
Purdue turnover. Shot doesn't fall for Pearson.
This is what makes him such a help to the team. Now he turns it over, but he's a good handler.
Back outside, Rayford, Vaughn, fakes, drives in, scores! draws the foul. No, it's an offensive foul. It's a charging foul.
This is the problem. People say others don't contribute. They've got major league players. This step in, like Ian Stanback, just good team basketball. You can't play with one great player, no matter how unusually stupendous he might be. Others have to do some things.
And now Purdue pulls it back as we approach 45 seconds to play.
They're trying to give it.
And the foul on Waddell.
Only 81%.
He will go to the line as Purdue looks to lock up a Saturday afternoon date against Duke.
As we look at Gene Cady, he has been around. He's got on the phone with one of the more illustrious athletic graduates of Purdue, John Wooden. And John said, let him have fun. Don't put too many new things in. Let him relax. And in talking to people around the program, it made him relax. He's been a very composed individual, enjoying his club, and why not, huh?
The way they're going. Purdue 9 of 10 from the floor tonight. Or from the free throw line. And that was kept out of bounds to Kansas. Gene Cady and the Boilermakers have 40 seconds to go.
Get this one to go for the three first.
Pearson's three, got it. And a timeout for Kansas. 33.5 to play. Kansas down two. We'll be back.
This is not unfamiliar territory for Purdue. Nine times they won a ball game by 5 points or less this season. Their four losses by a total of 12 points. They're used to close games. If you're Kansas, who do you foul?
Well, they don't have many choices. Darner in the game, a 38% shooter. Matt Waddell missed the last one, but they'll keep it in Waddell or Robinson's hands.
Robinson.
Gotta give it.
And that was Darner with the ball.
Now the spread.
And now they foul Konzo Martin, who shoots 73%.
Now you communicate defensively, if you're Kansas, on how you've got to screen everybody, step in, make a squeeze, get a miss. The push, they're very good at that fast break off the free throw. We've seen it earlier in the game. And the big thing if you're Purdue, you don't want to foul on a miss with a reach over.
Martin has been to the free throw line once tonight, and he made it.
Dove in the game. The problem with him is he is a terrific jumper. You don't want him to get involved on a foul, but defensively, he's very sound. Can rag a guy.
1-1 for Martin.
Well, all the accolades are going to go to Glenn Robinson if they win. But Martin has been providing big baskets, particularly in the second half, knocking down shots, and defensively has excelled.
This one will make it a two-possession game for Kansas. Purdue by four, 29 for Martin.
Gotta get it quick.
Pearson.
The three by good defense. They couldn't get into their offense, the cuts, the post up, because Purdue was ready. Right here, they keep everything out, no gambles, very sound. You can see the contesting even of the three. And you mentioned the two-trip game, a deuce would have been just as good.
This will be Roberts' first free throw tonight. .2 on the clock.
Okay, guys. Hey.
Roberts has not scored tonight. He has 7 rebounds. Purdue having to inbound the ball down.
And they're open to a deep pass. You'll see Kansas trying to fake drawing the charge or give it away immediately so the clock doesn't move. But they are vulnerable to a deep pass in this set.
Roberts. And Roberts fouled with 4.6 to play.
When you think of it, you mentioned a two-trip game and you end up taking the three. Try and get it inside and get the deuce and then counter with another steal or another opportunity. And this group played solid, though.
Purdue 13 out of 15 from the line, and Roberts will try to improve on that. Gene Katie, 14 great years coaching at Purdue. This will be the first time that he's gone as far as the Final Eight.
And nobody has written about his kids when they leave. There's obviously some great success stories in the world of business and life, but the NBA, a lot of programs churn them out every year. He doesn't have that kind of a situation. He's got good college basketball teams, and now with the likes of Glenn Robinson, a lot of people pay a lot more attention, but they have done it year in and year out, up top of that conference, and as we noted, 1-4 times.
And with 0.5 to play, one last inbound pass from Purdue.
That guy's got style on that sideline there.
Roy Williams said, don't foul.
No, just a big timer. What his kids did today, he couldn't ask any more of. Dignity and style, that's what they're going out with.
What a terrific basketball game.
Loved it.
Purdue will meet Duke on Saturday here in Knoxville. Glenn Robinson leads the top-seeded Boilermakers to a date with Duke on Saturday. 44 points on 15 of 33 shooting. Glenn Robinson of Purdue, Richard Scott of Kansas, our Chevrolet players of the game. Pat O'Brien and James Brown back in our studios in New York in just a moment. For Andrea Joyce and Bill Raftery, I'm Greg Gumbel saying so long from Knoxville, Tennessee.
The water bug inside to Owen. What an exhibition for Arizona, not only with the ball, but without the ball. They played an outstanding defensive game as Osborne hits a three. Where were they earlier in the game when Louisville took 5 three-point baskets? And a pushing foul called against Tick Rogers. So Arizona will now advance to the regional finals. And in the game here at the Sports Arena, here in Los Angeles on Saturday, Arizona and Missouri. Missouri number one, Arizona number two seed will tip it off at 3:40 Eastern time, followed by Duke and Purdue, who were the first and second seeds in the Southeast from Knoxville.
That game will be a war because Arizona comes close to matching the full force underneath.
Let me ask you this question now. Do you think that overtime win by Missouri over Syracuse might have taken something out of them going into Saturday's game?
No, it would have taken something out of Syracuse, but Missouri is deep and they're physically strong. As I said earlier about Missouri, the Tigers, they got about 9 guys with truck bodies.
They do, and they did, and Syracuse with great guards. As Bolton and Autry with a tremendous 60-point effort between them in a losing cause.
That one guy there looked like Nightcore, looked like Bull on the bench.
Each member of the starting five for the Wildcats in double figures. led by Reeves, is 27 points. Tick Rogers with under a minute to go. 77-64 in favor of Arizona, and Louisville with a foul with Wheat stopping the clock. And right now, the Chevrolet players of the game, Dwayne Morton at this point with 21 points. Player of the game from Louisville, and Khalid Reeves with 27 points. And remember, Reeves did not score the first 5.5 minutes of this game, but he sure made him up in a hurry.
Well, he's the only recruit from New York City. Very rarely do they get one from that part of the country at Arizona.
Reeves makes the first, and you saw Dwayne Morton leave the ball game. He too is a senior, so Miner and Morton have played their last game in a Louisville uniform. 29 for Khalid Reeves. On the turnover, Stoudemire, and Reeves couldn't hold it out of bounds.
I don't know if that three on his jersey is from hitting from three-point land or but just accident that's number three.
It'll be interesting if he can get over 30, because he scored 32 and 30 in the first two games of his tournament. He's got 29 right now. He remains in the game. Matt Simons and Alvin Sims come in, and Dylan Rigdon comes in for Arizona. Reeves will go out having scored 29 points.
He's a tired young man.
But he will play another game, as will this Wildcat squad against the Missouri Tigers on Saturday.
A beautiful mix in this game of their baseline, especially with Blair and Owens tied in with their backcourt. They really controlled the game all the way.
Sims hits the three. Louisville never led in this game. 79-67. And a foul called against Sims, and Stoudemire will go to the line. The win for Arizona will move them into the regional final for only the second time in their history. Back in 1988, they beat the North Carolina Tar Heels, and Lute Olson's team advanced to the Final Four for the only time, and they lost to Oklahoma in the national semifinals, and so much has been expected and anticipated of Arizona in recent years.
Well, Lute Olson had more pressure on him coming into this tournament than any of the 64 coaches. The last two rounds, he stubbed his toe in the first game out of the gate.
Right.
2 years ago, I think it was Eastern Tennessee, and last year it was the team from California.
And in 91, they lost to Seton Hall in the Western Regional Semis, lost to UNLV 2 years prior to that in the semis, but they're going to the regional finals now. Wheat misses the shot. Erie brings it up, 80-67. All five Wildcats started the game, scored in double figures, but their defense told the story of this game. And no basket, there's a foul as Dylan Rigdon. They're going to count it. It is the basket by Dylan Rigdon. Stoudemire goes out of the game. 11 points, 7 assists, and I think he picked off 7 rebounds as well.
Rigdon's an outstanding foul shooter. In high school, at one spot, he hit 50 out of 51. He's a transfer from UC Irvine.
He missed it, and you know, he had the longest streak of 29 in a row before he missed that shot.
You talk about Alina that time by Osborne.
3-point basket, and the game is over. Arizona wins going away. And Lute Olson will go against Norm Stewart in Saturday's regional final. Accepts congratulations from Denny Crum. Final score, Arizona 82 and Louisville 70. Morton with 21, the high score for the Cardinals, and Reeves at 29 for Arizona. Arizona now 28-5 on the season. So it'll be the number one and number two seeds clashing here at the Sports Arena, Missouri and Arizona. Pat O'Brien will come back with the update for you. Al McGuire and Dick Stockton saying so long from Los Angeles. Arizona prevails.
Early in the morning. Good morning, everybody, from New York. I'm Pat O'Brien, along with the godfather of college basketball, James Brown. And JB, how you doing tonight? Arizona beats Louisville 82-70, and Louisville just kind of sat there the whole game.
Oh, speaking of sitting, I mean, Clifford Rozier sitting right in that little six-foot area in the blocks, didn't do a good job of presenting himself, making a nice target. Plus, got to give a lot of credit to Arizona's defense, sloughing in there. Horrible game.
Arizona looks good. They're spinning through this tournament, and so they beat Louisville. They'll go on to play Missouri, who beat Syracuse 98-88. Missouri's last regional final was in 1976, and they lost to Michigan there. Down in the Southeast Regional, Purdue and Kansas, it was all big dog. Glenn Robinson, 83-78 was the final. The big dog scored 44 points on the night, and he had a big one. In the Southeast Regional, the other game, Duke beat Marquette 59-49. A little scare early in the game, but they prevailed, went on to win by 10 points, and now it'll be the big dog. Okay, well, first of all, in the West, it'll be Missouri and Arizona. What an area this is. The 1 and 2 seed end up in that one, and that's the bracket out west.
Missouri deep. I don't think you can vote against them at all. Arizona, nice job in the backcourt, but still thin along the front line.
Moving along on our brackets in the Southeast, Duke and Purdue, Grant Hill against Glenn Robinson. That'll be some game to watch on Saturday. Moving along in the brackets, and we quickly go to the East, and there you see the games we'll have tomorrow night. We'll talk about that in a moment. Boston College, Indiana, Florida, and Connecticut. And in the Midwest, those four games yet to be played, Arkansas, Tulsa, Michigan, and Maryland. And we'll be back with more from New York City right after this. Stay with us.
Quick glance underneath for Henderson. Abrams guarding Evans. Here's Bailey. Huckabee out on him. 10 on the shot clock.
Really looking to try to get it into Henderson. Now they're going to have to fight the shot clock.
Bailey, the senior, takes the shot. Rims out. Boston College ball.
Well, he got a good look. His defender fell down. Now you go right inside, Vern. You go back to Curley inside and try to force Indiana to foul you. Henderson and actually Curley and Evans really going at each other.
Abrams passes on the shot. Isley takes it. Evans for three. No. Boston College has the ball. Foul in the backcourt.
Not that good a free throw shooter. He looks like he's slightly injured, but he just told the official, Charlie Strange, that he's okay. You know, I met Gerard Abrams' uncle, They call him Uncle Joe, and he told me he sent Jim O'Brien the videotape that allowed Jim O'Brien to say, hey, this is a guy I'd like to have, and now he's at the line looking to give this team a six-point lead.
Indiana has called timeout. They've got one left.
You must be certified by the NCAA Initial Eligibility Clearinghouse. Ask your coach or guidance counselor for one of these student release forms. Fill it out and send it to the clearinghouse. Remember, if you're not certified, you can't compete as a freshman in NCAA Division I or II. For more information, call 319-337-1492.
The Oscars of college basketball. Best male player, best female player. The envelope, please. The Van Naismith Awards, Sunday on CBS.
Gerard Abram, only a 50% free throw shooter, but in the first round win over Washington State, he sank two free throws to cinch the victory, and he's at the line again.
Yeah, he's a big shot taker and a big shot maker. With him, sometimes you have to throw his numbers out of the window. He's a little volatile, he's excitable, but that energy level he brings is something that Boston College has appreciated throughout his career.
Got two more.
if you're BC, don't let Indiana get a quick look at the three. And that's what they've done all this half, Vern, is force Indiana to use a lot of clock before shooting.
Damon Bailey's shot is short. Abram has it. 10 seconds remaining. Foul. The run may be over for the Indiana Hoosiers.
And boy, did they max it out, Vern. I just looked at Pat Graham when he committed that foul. He grimaced because that left foot is hurting. Hasn't practiced for probably 4 weeks with any kind of consistency. Bailey, that pulled stomach muscle, one of the worst injuries you can have, athlete or not, especially when you're talking about basketball. And this team has really just fought and fought and fought. And they ran into Boston College Club that was able to make enough big plays down the stretch.
How about this improbability as Pat Knight enters the game? 2 weeks ago, Boston College was blown out by Georgetown by 23 points, and that man's job was said to be on the line. Since then, having obtained an invitation to the NCAA tournament, all they've done is knock off Washington State, North Carolina, and they're 10 points away from whipping Indiana. Foul on Pat Graham.
And the thing about it is, not only did Jim O'Brien have to go through tremendous adversity with this program and team, but personal tragedy stepped into his life recently, well, in the last 3 years. And I tell you what, he's got to be feeling tremendous right now for these kids and the way they've been able to grow each year and now still alive in the tournament.
Those of you around the country may not know that Jim O'Brien lost his wife, who was his college sweetheart, Christine. Her heart failed her 3 years ago. He has two daughters, Amy and Erin, both great athletes. And this one-time star guard of Boston College, whose job was said to be in jeopardy, has his team in the Elite Eight. The last 9 points of the ball game scored by the Eagles. The improbable journey will continue. Now let's go to Leslie Visser with Jim O'Brien and a couple of players.
Well, Boston College's magical history tour continues. Congratulations on to the regional final. Jimmy, the Carolina and Indiana back-to-back. How'd you do it?
Well, I think it just shows a lot of character on the part of these kids. They've just really dug down, and they've played with a lot of heart and determination right now, Leslie.
Well, Harold, you hit the shot with 8 seconds left on the shot clock. What were you looking to do there?
We were looking to go inside, but it didn't open up, and I just thought I could take my man to the basket and pull up, and that's what I did.
Now, congratulations to you. The three-point shot was open early the whole game.
Yeah, we knew we were going to get a lot of open shots. We knew they were going to pack it down low on Billy Curley. We just had to step up and hit our big shots again, the same way we did against North Carolina. You know, when we open up the middle for Billy Curley, it's tough to stop down low. So we're happy to be here.
Can you put this in perspective, Jimmy? What does this mean?
Not yet. I mean, we just won two games over the two of the better programs in America, and our kids just deserve a lot of credit. I'm just hoping we can have a good effort now on Sunday.
We're going on to the regional final. Congratulations. Back to you.
All right, Leslie, our final score is 77-68. All four seniors were in double figures. So for Clark Kellogg and Leslie Visser, I'm Bert Lundquist. Thanks so long from Marine Miami Arena. BC wins it. Florida and UConn are next.
All right. Well-
will be back there in about a half an hour. We'll get you a tip time in a moment for Florida, UConn, and Indiana goes out of the tournament. Boston College 77-68, and the Sports Illustrated jinx no longer here. It says take that Tar Heels, and you can just insert an Indiana over that. Take that Indiana, JB. What a win for BC.
No doubt about it. And, you know, I really like Bill Curley. I know we talk so much about Boston College doing a great job from three-point land, but Bill Curley, again, a very mediocre first half, but he stayed with it. 13 rebounds, 11 points. I really think he came through when they needed him.
As I said, take that Indiana. I dropped this earlier, and there it is. I'm going to get it right. I'm going to stick with this bit, and there it is. All right. Let's tell everybody what's going to come out later on this evening. Around 10 o'clock, we're going to tip Maryland-Michigan is our other big game tonight. The Wolverines against Maryland, and then in the East, Florida and Connecticut. The tip of that is going to be about 30 minutes from now. We'll get you an exact tip time. In fact, we have it now. It's 9:56 Eastern time for Florida and UConn, and Vern Lundquist and Clark Kellogg will be along for that one. Meantime, there's a game going on out in Dallas in the Midwest Regional, Arkansas and Tulsa. Arkansas leads 74-58. Let's go to Jim Nance and Billy Packer for that.
Tipped in by Corliss Williamson as you join us. Arkansas now with its largest lead, 18-point advantage. Long-range three, Gary Collier.
Gary Collier, three.
Arkansas led in this half at one time by 16. Tulsa went to a lineup with its tallest player being 6'4". They trimmed the lead to 8, but then Arkansas responded going small, and they got the lead right back up there again.
Can we talk about tired legs sometimes? And then you have guys that really have fresh feet. And McDaniel, he is flying tonight. Obviously got off to a good offensive first half, but he is really moving.
Timeout on the floor. Arkansas up 15.
Best performance of the season. Coming off,
there we see the Maryland players, Joe Smith, X-ray hit, two of their key players. That
they don't look too wound up or nervous about facing Michigan, do they? Underneath, Wilson lost it going up. Saves it to Bonner now. On Dillard.
Of course, in that game coming up, the last time that Gary Williams brought a team in here, he brought Boston College in here, lost in the NCAA tournament to Memphis State.
That's the last time he was in the Sweet 16, right. 1980.
Three on two. Deron Shepherd.
You can't draw it any better than that, Burr. Fill your lane. Your tallest guy on the floor is in the middle and makes the right choice on the dime.
22-year-old Israeli has 12 points early in the game. And King's going to get called for a second foul.
Fast break basketball at its best. Marshall just handles it himself. Makes the defender make a decision and finds Shepherd on the left lane.
For Florida now, number three, Brian Thompson comes in. And Jason Anderson goes to the bench. 24-15 with 10:03 to go in the first half of play. Kuzma for three. No.
That's where Kuzma likes to shoot it from. He's made 24 three-point shots this year. UConn doing a nice job defensively.
Thompson couldn't find anybody to throw it to. Now across. Short gets the rebound.
Gators really have been having to work extremely hard to get shots.
Sheffer. Donnie Marshall. Whoop. Got it back. And a chance for a double-digit lead if they can convert here.
Much of an inside presence other than Hill. Well, everybody on the perimeter having to do extra work to get looks, and UConn defense taxing the Gators right now.
Brown. Yes. 24-17, 8:45 remaining first half. Shepherd looks inside. Hey.
Want to remind some of you again that you'll be leaving us in just a few minutes to see the Maryland-Michigan game that is getting ready to tip off from Reunion Arena in Dallas. You'll be kept up to date with the progress of this game with scoring reports and highlights. Our score right now 24-17 with 8:35 to go in the first half. DeClercq back in the lineup for the Gators of Florida. And Greg Williams, a freshman guard from Fairfax, Virginia, number 10, is in. Oh, nifty pass, and DeClercq with a good, strong move, gets the basket and the foul.
Good weak side cut to the basketball, and a bullet down by Craig Brown. Had to get it there quickly on a rope, and there's Andrew DeClercq. Hayward late reacting and knows it. Foul and the finish.
Lane violation.
DeClercq with that little hitch in his shot baited one of the Huskies into the lane early.
Sheppard with a rebound for UConn, 24-19, 8:21 to go first half. First meeting ever between these teams from the Big East and the SEC. Greg Williams, all the way, off the shot. Rudy Johnson loses it, and then Florida loses it. And time has been called with 7:59 remaining first half. UConn up by 5. Seconds remaining in regulation. UConn has the ball. They will send Kevin Ollie, Travis Knight, Daron Sheppard, Danielle Marshall, and Ray Allen on the court.
If you're UConn, you try to get it to Marshall. I think you take this shot with about 4 seconds on the clock to see if you can get a second shot in case it doesn't go.
Jason Anderson on defensively. He's guarding Sheppard right now. Here's Danielle Marshall. The clock at 5. Marshall with the jumper. But he was fouled. And he'll have a chance to give UConn the lead with 3.4 seconds left.
The personal foul is charged. Number 55, Andrew DeClercq. It is his fourth personal and an attempted foul against Florida.
There's the touch right there on the elbow. Marshall got a good look.
Danielle Marshall is 5 of 6 from the line tonight. Timeout, Florida. Four seconds remaining in regulation. At this point in the ball game, UConn has made 6 more free throws than Florida. Danielle Marshall has one more attempt to give UConn the lead.
If in fact Marshall makes this, UConn goes up 1. I would think Florida would try to inbound the ball to half court and then call their last time out to set up a last second shot.
This isn't doing any good for Danielle Marshall.
No, it certainly isn't. Good point. Icing him just a bit more as players get their assignments and take their position.
Marshall is 5 of 7 for the evening. This would put UConn back on top. Time.
Florida. With 1.7 seconds remaining. Officials are, by rule, allowed to use a replay to rectify a score or timer's mistake. And this is what happened during the timeout. Tom Rucker, the referee, looked at the replay. You see that time was called with 1.7 seconds remaining. That's Tom Rucker on the left, Dan Crispin, the standby official, on the right. They were checking when DeClercq called and asked for the timeout. They have decided to put 0.7 seconds back on the clock. So Rucker is now explaining it to Jim Calhoun and Lon Kruger. But by rule, Tom Rucker was allowed to correct a timing mistake. There's the proper use of the replay. And they have put 2.4 seconds on the clock.
Exactly. Well done and well documented. Now Florida just wants to get it inbound.
Oh, my! It was almost obtained by Travis Knight.
Well, there's no reason to throw the ball on the floor in the backcourt. You've only got 2 seconds. You've got to get it across half court with your pass here. Gators lucky to retain possession.
DeClercq to Hill. We've got overtime. It took a while, but Florida fought back. They're tied at 57 with the University of Connecticut Huskies. 5-minute overtime coming up. That's each time is granted one additional timeout, which means that UConn has 2 timeouts now, and Florida will have 1. Overtime is also an extension of the second half that relates to personal fouls and so on. Well, how many times have there been overtime in the tournament? Single overtimes, 101. Double overtimes, 12. Triple overtimes, 4. And there have been 4 quadruple overtimes.
Well, look for Donyell Marshall, who missed 2 free throws that possibly could have given UConn the win, to really look to try to take over in this overtime period, I would think. Florida, on the other hand, blew plenty of opportunities in the last 5 minutes, and yet they too have new life.
Marshall and DeClercq, and it's controlled by Florida. The Gators have Cross and Brown, Jason Anderson, DeClercq, and Dimitri Hill. Last night it was Syracuse and Missouri. Tonight, Florida and UConn. And Dimitri Hill, Travis Knight with the block.
Good help by Donyell Marshall. Hill had nowhere to go with that one.
Shepherd, no. DeClercq with the rebound. Cross running. Or Brown, rather. Throws it right to Jerome Shepherd. At the other end, Ollie. Marshall. Off his hand. Florida ball. Anybody's nervous out there.
Well, again, I mentioned I thought Connecticut played a little tight the last 7 or 8 minutes. But Florida unable to really take advantage of that.
3 seconds to go.
I think Jason Anderson may have gotten a piece of that.
The first 3-point basket hit by either team in the second half and overtime. Gators are up by 4 at the 1:15 mark. Craig Brown hit a 3-pointer. And the Norwegian and the Finn led the Scandinavian skyline to even higher proportions. Here's Ollie.
You need a good high percentage shot quickly if you're UConn. You don't want to waste too much time.
55 seconds remaining. UConn, the second seed, down by 4. Shepherd spots up for the 3. The rebound in the hands of Florida. trying to get to the Elite Eight for the first time in the school's history. Daron Sheffer with the foul.
Well, Dan Cross didn't like how hard he was hit. I don't think anything malicious intended. Cross to concentrate on the task at hand now. This could give them a six-point cushion. Really didn't need the three-point shot, although Sheffer got a good look at one. Just didn't follow through.
This is the largest lead Florida has enjoyed tonight. Kevin Ollie heads out. And the margin came on a three-point basket by the only senior in the starting lineup, Craig Brown. And Dan Cross throws a little frustration at himself.
Yeah, an 85% free throw shooter. He's hovering around 50% tonight.
4 of 8. 5 of 9. And the Gators have their largest lead. It comes with 35 seconds left in overtime. Marshall. No. Sheffer. They need the three-pointer. Ray Allen takes it. No. Dimitri Hill fouled in the backcourt. Kruger was the coach at Kansas State. He got his team into the regional final in that game. They lost to a guy named Danny Manning and the Kansas Jayhawks, who went on to win the national title. This time, he's got his 10-year-old son, Kevin, on the bench as a good luck charm.
He had a pretty good player back then, too, Mitch Richmond, who went on the following year to be the NBA's Rookie of the Year. But the Gators, they win ugly. They don't do anything spectacular. They haven't shot it well from the free throw line, but I think more than what Florida has done, I think it's the fact that Connecticut has been flat and careless, and then I think the weight of being the favorite when they weren't able to put it away earlier in the second half really started to show itself.
Seconds remain. The Florida Gators lead by 5. Neither team with a timeout remaining. UConn has a possession arrow, but Florida has a 5-point lead with 15.6 seconds left. And Kevin Ollie gets called for the foul. This is a UConn team that is back in the NCAA after a one-year hiatus. They missed last year with a 15-13 record. But it is not a senior-dominated team. There are no seniors in the starting five, Clark.
Yeah, they're a young club. Ray Allen is going to get better. Had an outstanding tournament until tonight, struggled with his teammates as far as shooting the ball, especially the last 22, 23 minutes or so. And part of that you attribute to the defense of the Gators, but you have to also make the point that UConn missed some shots and turned the ball over an awful lot when they had a chance maybe to stretch the lead to a comfortable double-digit mark.
Lead is back to 7 as Cross hits 2. Ollie to Sheffer. Ollie has it misfire. Here's Cross behind the back. And the senior will put the period to the paragraph. 27-all. And then they win it by nine. The biggest basket of the night came with 1:15 remaining in overtime. A three-pointer by the senior guard, Craig Brown. It's Boston College against Florida, the number 3 seed against the number 9 seed, Sunday at 1:40 Eastern time from the Miami Arena. The Chevrolet players of the game, Craig Brown from Florida. He had 17 points, 9 assists, 9 rebounds, and Daron Sheffer for the UConn Huskies. 69-60 the final here. Right now, let's go back to Pat O'Brien in our New York studios.
All right, Vern, thank you. Good job. So that sets up an unlikely final for Sunday, Florida and Boston College. Let's now go back to Dallas and Michigan and Maryland. 4:24 left. Here's Jim Nance and Billy Packer.
Maryland has scored 8 unanswered.
And Jim, in the first game against Pepperdine, which Michigan won in overtime, they have a habit of doing that. Jackson and Howard both fouled out.
Get up. And a rebound by Rose. What a 3-3 this is. Tip Howard. And Ray Jackson with the rebound.
Maryland maybe a little over anxious there. Still plenty of time in this game.
All 5 Michigan starters in double figures tonight. They've led by as many as 20 in this half. It's now 11 with 4 minutes remaining.
Down to 10 seconds.
Fife almost had it taken away. Put up a knuckleball and Smith rebound.
Well, they had the ball in the hands of they wanted to get it in Jalen's hands when they get down low at the clock.
Rhodes, he hit a big 3 a moment ago.
And down to 9.
Down to 9, single digits.
And now, see, now you got to ask your starters to pump it back up again, Jim, both emotionally and physically. And they've been on the floor a long time. I don't believe Jalen and Juwan have been out, have they?
Well, they've been playing, I think, the whole second half.
1 minute. We understand 1 minute they've been out of this game.
Howard. And one. Racking up some big numbers again tonight. 24 with 15 in this half.
Dwayne Simpkins, his third personal foul.
There's Juwan with a leaner on the inside. Huge basket for a Michigan team that was having a run put on him. Slices right through. Simpkins not big enough to stop him. Juwan continues his tremendous play in the NCAA tournament.
He's got a double-double already, Billy, with 11 rebounds and now looking for 25.
Well, he's coming off 28-9 and a 34-18 game. Points and rebounds.
Joe Smith. Blocked by Howard. They said it. Piece in the arm.
That's his 5th, isn't it?
Here's a guy that is his 5th. He did not commit a single foul in 39 minutes against Texas. And tonight, he fouls out with all of his personals called in the second half.
Now, Juwan better be careful in regard to his language right here. Technical foul would be huge.
Now, Joe Smith, who was silenced in the first half, did not make a single shot from the floor. Now we'll have the opportunity to go the final 2:49 without Howard on him. Timeout called by Michigan. When we come back, Joe Smith at the line for 2. Maryland down 11.
UConn 60.
Billy, Maryland on a 10-2 run. And in fact, with 8:50 remaining in the game, Michigan led by 21. 66-45.
Jim, that's at the point where I really thought it was in their best interest to rest their starters because they were losing some concentration. Take a chance that the subs could hang on for 4 or 5 minutes. and work the game on out. But right now, they still have a potential dogfight if Maryland were to be able to turn the ball over on them any. You know, with the three-point shot, almost three possessions if he hits this one.
Howard is fouled out. Maryland has no timeouts remaining. Gets it. Nope. So Smith 4-for-8 from the line. They've missed 17 free throws tonight.
Unbelievable. Trying to double team, turning the ball over now. You expect the ball in Jalen's hands, but X-ray hips falling everywhere he goes, realizing that's where Michigan wants it. By X-ray hip, he stepped in and stopped the handoff.
Lucas in.
3 seconds left in the shot clock.
Lucas comes in, only three on the clock. 2:17 remaining in the game, 10-point advantage.
Joe Smith was taken out of the game. Now, without any timeouts, how are they going to get him back in?
Got to shoot it. Ingi almost made it. Now Maryland, 2:10 to go.
Surprised Gary Williams took Joe Smith out, but because without any timeouts, Jim.
Rose, three-pointer. Booth saves it. Puts it up high off the glass to cut it to 8.
Boy, does he have some ability in there to create the shot.
Plays much bigger than 6'5".
See, Jim, here you have, sitting on the side, Joe Smith. They can't get him back in the game. Time's going off.
Down the pipe. Stolen by Rose. Back to Booth, to Hip. Ooh, Mr. Chippy gets it back. Hip makes it 6. 1:30 remaining. They've made up 15 points in the last 7 minutes.
They're trapping all over the floor. Jalen Rose finally calms things down.
He is a calming influence for this team when they get in a situation like this.
Well, I think X-ray Hip is so exhausted from the offensive maneuver, he couldn't go out and chase Jalen. See, he can hardly move. Letting a lot of valuable time go off here.
5 on the line. 57 seconds to go. Joe Smith checks back in.
Jalen telling the referee was hit on the arm a little bit too late there. And now Jalen goes over and has a little conversation with X-ray and said, you know you hit me. Almost like they're on the playground somewhere.
Booth goes out. Simpkins back in. Simpkins, Lucas, who can fire a three. Rhodes, Smith, and Hip on the floor for Maryland. Remember, no timeouts for Maryland.
And remember also, the other steadying influence, particularly on the defensive end of the floor, Juwan Howard has fouled out.
To the hoop. Push off on Ingi. Send Smith to the line for 2.
Not what you want if you're Steve Fisher, because you want the time to go by and not stop this clock.
Bristol and Booth come back in for Maryland.
And Wayne Bristol return.
Jim, they hit these 2. Put them down 6, so you're on one of those 2 possession runs. Gary Williams wants his team to start thinking about fouling a little bit.
Maryland 18-35 from the line tonight. One more for Smith. Cut it to 6.
Michigan showed they can make some free throws in the Pepperdine game. They made 10 straight in overtime. So now you can expect them to be put on the line here on these inbounds passes.
King will go to the line.
That was Bristol's job.
King will shoot 2. They're in the double bonus.
Wayne Bristol with his second personal foul.
35.8.
Jimmy King, despite the fact that he's a slashing type player, Jimmy, you look at his stats. He's only been to the foul line 74 times this year. 66% free throw shooter. He's a guy that should get to the line much more, don't you think?
Much as he drives,
yeah. I mean, he's capable.
Oh boy.
Now, here's the key thing. When you've got a guy that doesn't shoot good free throws, you have to be aware of the potential miss and get ready to rebound. So many times we see guys getting the boards, and look at Jalen Rose out here. I'm surprised he's not on the line.
Michigan's missed four straight. A three could make it a one-possession game. Rhodes, no, I thought he was going to fire it. Here's Simpkins instead.
Short.
Underneath, a push called against Booth.
Pushing off.
That'll be it for him.
Yep.
Just like Howard, Booth committed all five of his fouls in the second half. Well, they had two trips in the last minute, down six. One time they turned it over, this time they committed the foul.
And Jim, what you saw there was almost like a little two-man weave that Maryland set up. I really think that Dwayne Simpkins is the kind of guy that's got the ability, he's powerful enough, low to the ground, to dribble and penetrate inside. It's very difficult to get a weave on the perimeter and then create a three-point shot off it.
Ray Jackson.
Lucas comes in for the Terrapins.
Ray Jackson, shirt out. Whatever happened to that rule, Jim? I thought
it didn't last long.
No, it sure did.
Five straight Michigan misses.
I really think Jalen Rose should be over on the lane because he's such a good rebounder. He's got great instincts for the ball. Here he is out at half court, serving no purpose.
Missing their last six. And a play by King just to use up a little more time. Good hustle. 21.8 to go. Maryland needs a couple of threes.
Exactly right. A two-point shot is not worth taking now, although the clock will stop. The weave, they can adjust to that.
Yep. And Jackson gets it ahead to Fife. Michigan's going to the regional final.
Jim, in Maryland's history, they have often lost to the national champ. 81, they lost to Indiana. 85 to Villanova. See any?
I think there's a possibility here.
My region?
I don't think so.
Curtis Schultz in for Maryland.
I give you something else that when you start going into Final Fours, there have been four teams that have gone to three straight Final Fours without winning.
Houston's one of them.
I'll give you a comeback on that one, though, but Houston is one. They lost in 82, 83, 84. Duke in 88, 89, and 90. North Carolina, 67, 68, 69. And Ohio State, 44, 45, and 46. That'd be tough to do. Wouldn't it be the Final Four three straight years and never have a championship? But I'll give you that comeback on Houston because that wasn't a dagger. 10 years ago today, I read it in the paper. 10 years ago today, Houston went to the Final Four by beating somebody in the regional final. You know who it was?
Memphis State?
My alma mater.
Wait. Okay.
So, there's your comeback.
Yeah, they made a great run in this tournament, Maryland. But Michigan's in the Final Eight. The Final Eight now has two from the Big Ten, two from the SEC, and one each from the Big Eight, Pac-10, Big East, and ACC. Here they are, Billy. Purdue and Duke, Missouri and Arizona, set for Saturday.
Boston College, they pulled off a little magic at that school one other time down in Miami.
Yes, they did.
Another sport, though.
Moody.
Yep.
And they say he's not a bad ball player.
Michigan and Arkansas will meet on Sunday. The right to go to Charlotte.
We welcome you back to Dallas. Michigan holds on to win by 7 points. And we are now joined by Steve Fisher, the head coach of Michigan. You're up by 20 points. And what happened to your team? It seemed like they lost concentration there in the last 10 minutes.
We did hold on barely. It was almost like we wanted to have another five-point game so we could add to the record, I guess. We weren't very good down the stretch, and we must be better against Arkansas. But we get a chance to play them.
That is the point, but... what do you tell your team now? You got to go from feeling very good about this victory to not feeling very good at all.
Oh no, I feel good. I feel great. We're in the grade eight. We're playing for a chance to go to the Final Four. Nobody said this game was perfect, and we proved that. We played well in spots. We played well to get a 20-point lead. We were abysmal as they came back. You can't do that. But I'm going to go in and say I'm proud of you. We'll come back, shoot some free throws tomorrow, talk on Arkansas. No, I'm not going to dampen my enthusiasm for this victory. I'll take three more just like that one.
I understand you will. Congratulations. We look forward to seeing you on Sunday.
Thank you.
Jim?
All right, Jim Gray, the Chevrolet players of the game. Booth, Keith Booth from Maryland, who had 17 points and 9 rebounds. Juwan Howard from Michigan, who had 24 points, 15 of them coming in the second half. Michigan finds a way to win. That's been their pattern. Win and advance. One more win, and they're going to the Final Four. Pat O'Brien, James Brown coming up when we continue on the road to the Final Four.
On CBS.
And so we have our Elite Eight, Pat O'Brien along with James Brown here in New York City. Let's go over the scores from this Friday night's action. Michigan beat Maryland, as you just saw, 78-71, setting up a meeting with Arkansas, who beat Tulsa 103-84. And what about Michigan and Arkansas, JB?
Michigan looking to get back to the Final Four for a third time. Major obstacle in Arkansas. I think a premium is going to be placed on ball handling in that contest. Arkansas's defense will be tenacious.
A scary game on Sunday. In the East Regional tonight, a couple of unlikely teams made it through, but they made it. Florida beat Connecticut 69-60 in overtime, and Boston College beat the Hoosiers of Indiana 77-68. Tomorrow, a big day here on CBS beginning at 1 o'clock. The men's Division II championship. Southern Indiana and Cal State Bakersfield. Then at 3 o'clock, JB and I will be here for the road to the Final Four. We'll be joined by Rick Pitino and Stu Jackson. Then at 3:40, the West Regional Final, Arizona and Missouri. And at 6 o'clock, about 6 o'clock, the Southeast Regional Final, Duke and Purdue. That's all tomorrow here on CBS. I'm Pat O'Brien for The Godfather. How do you feel?
Despite the red eyes, I feel good.
Good night, everybody.